The president calling the president of Russia. Maybe he thinks he's a killer.
I have directed Secretary Connolly to suspend temporarily the convertibility of the dollar into gold or other reserve
assets. And if somehow this great American free enterprise system, we no longer get it. It's almost an embarrassment being an American citizen and listening to the stupid shit we have to deal with in this country.
I most respectfully request that that matter not be
touched. Mr. Gorbachev, tear down this wall.
It was the most dangerous moment since the Cuban Missile Crisis. It was the front line of a complex multi-generational conflict. It was a war that aimed to crumble the global order that united Western nations. It was a war meant to fracture the NATO alliance. It was a war that galvanized it. In late 2021, thoughts of massive Russian military movements began to appear on social media. Thousands of tanks headed towards the border of Ukraine, Europe's second largest country, with a population of 43 million. Russia, commanding the world's second largest military, was preparing for war. In the cradle of spring, Russia will launch the largest invasion since World War II.
We must be the great arsenal of democracy. For us, this is an emergency as serious as war itself.
Protected by two oceans and initially reluctant to join the war, the United States emerged from the aftermath of World War II as a global superpower. Germany's Third Reich accepted total defeat. Imperial Japan was dismantled. Though victorious in the war, the sun set on the British Empire. An American-led international order meet the end of European colonialism. The United States had a new vision for the world, where liberal idealism and multilateral cooperation replaced empires and conflict. The new world order would be built on capitalism, democracy, free trade, human rights, and religious tolerance.
We look forward to a world founded upon four essential human freedoms. The first is freedom of speech and expression everywhere in the world. The second is freedom of every person to worship God in his own way, everywhere in the world. The third is freedom from want, which translated into world terms means economic understanding, which will secure to every nation a healthy, peacetime life for its inhabitants everywhere in the world. The fourth is freedom from fear, which translated into world terms means a worldwide reduction of armaments to such a point and in such a thorough fashion that no nation will be in a position to commit an act of physical aggression against any neighbor anywhere in the world.
The United States created international institutions for global governance. The United Nations, the International Monetary Fund, the World Bank, the World Economic Forum, the International Organization for Standardization, the World Health Organization, the World Trade Organization, the World Trade Centers. Even the internet began life as a Department of Defense project. Held a month after the D-Day landings at Normandy, the United Nations Monetary and Financial Conference, held at Bretton Woods, established the U.S. dollar as the world's reserve currency.
There's never been such a far-reaching proposal on so great a scale to provide employment to the present and increase productivity in the future. We've been working quietly away in the cool woods and mountains of New Hampshire. And I doubt if the world yet understands how big a thing we are bringing to birth.
With great power came great wealth. The war years finally ended the Great Depression, and the United States emerged as the most prosperous nation in history. At the end of the war, the United States held 70% of the world's industrial capacity. A teenager in 1956 could earn what an entire family earns just a decade prior. A 100-year prelude of innovation blossomed into a modern society that dazzled the world. The standard of living in America was unmatched.
These are the 36 men who built this house. Another day, another 40 houses.
But it would not be a world without conflict. Mexico loaded with Hitler in the early part of the war, only to be betrayed when the two armies met at the Curzon Line. Germany's vision for ethnic-based national socialism included a secret plan to enslave millions of Slavs, relocating many more to Siberia, to make room for German colonies in Eastern Europe. Germany's Eastern Front pushed communist Russia into an unlikely partnership with the other Allied powers. The kinship was short-lived. The Soviet Union rejected the Bretton Woods agreements and refused to sign the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. Germany was divided into East and West, with Berlin divided into communist and capitalist zones. From the Baltics to the Balkans, European territories occupied by the Soviet Union became tightly controlled socialist republics. Self-sufficiency was favored over economic collaboration. Western leaders, policymakers, and statesmen saw a global power struggle between capitalism and communism looming. Hope for cooperation dimmed as the Soviets backed a communist civil war in Greece, conducted a coup in Czechoslovakia, and blockaded West Berlin. A policy of containment ensued. With the bulk of US troops home from war, NATO was formed to protect Western Europe from further Soviet aggression. An attack against one NATO member was to be considered an attack against them all.
I believe that it must be the policy of the United States to support free peoples who are resisting attempted subjugation by armed minorities or by outside pressures.
the Chinese government, backed by the United States, fellow communist revolutionaries. This ignited fears that communism, and with it Soviet influence, would spread to the rest of Asia. The Soviets refused to cooperate with a UN resolution for a unified Korea, which would have reunited the Soviet-occupied North with the US-occupied South. Then boycotted the UN altogether, for refusing to recognize China's new government.
Peoples of the free world, acting under the United Nations, have given their answer, and the United States, in a swift, bold decision, has already gone into action.
When Soviet dictator Joseph Stalin hesitantly endorsed an invasion by the North, South Korea was defended under the banner of the United Nations.
There are many people in the world who really don't understand, or say they don't, what is the great issue between the free world and the communist world. Let them come to Berlin. Some who say that communism is the wave of the future, let them come to Berlin.
The United States fought another war of containment in Vietnam. China and the Soviet Union provided weapons and equipment to the communist North Vietnamese. At home, the government wore the specter of communist subversion would creep into American society.
Tonight we have a second special report from Ford Rowan on government spying by computer. This one on a secret computer network being tying together other computer networks through some very advanced technology.
NBC News has learned that the government has built a secret electronic intelligence network. It gives the White House, the CIA, and the Defense Department instant access to computer files on millions of Americans.
Congress has always been afraid that computers, if all linked together, could turn the government into Big Brother, with the computers making it dangerously easy to keep tabs on everyone.
The federal government now has the means to put together a computer file on almost any American within a matter of minutes.
Colonel North, in your work at the NSC, were you not assigned at one time to work on plans for the continuity of government in the event of a major disaster?
I was particularly concerned, Mr. Chairman, because I read in Miami papers and several others that there had been a plan developed by that same agency, a contingency plan in the event of emergency that would suspend the American Constitution, and I was deeply concerned about it and wondered if that was the area in which he had worked. I believe that it was.
May I most respectfully request that that matter not be touched upon at this stage. If we wish to get into this, I'm certain arrangements can be made for an executive session.
No direct military operations were ever conducted during the Cold War. The fall of the Berlin Wall in 1989 created a domino effect that ultimately led to the collapse of the Soviet Union. Russia was opened up to the West, while Moscow's satellite states, including Ukraine, declared their independence. Yugoslavia, a socialist state that had been ostracized from the Soviet Union in the aftermath of World War II, also began to break apart. Ethnic tensions inside the country escalated into war and genocide, as the country split into independent states. When United Nations peacekeepers failed to stop the bloodshed in the newly independent Bosnia, NATO intervened. In Kosovo, a United Nations coalition was similarly ineffective. But UN authorization for NATO action was blocked by China and Russia. This prompted NATO to take action without UN approval, in an operation that included 1,000 aircraft, flying 30,000 combat missions, and cruise missile strikes from submarines. Russia also intervened. The standoff over an airfield nearly led to a direct confrontation between NATO and Russian forces.
If we can encourage democracy, if we can help build institutions across the Balkans, whereby people will relate not on the basis of their ethnicity, but on the basis of their political rights as individuals in free societies, in free and open societies, we could still have a Balkans that is at peace.
The triumph of capitalism and democracy over fascism and communism in the context of a world experiencing rapid globalization gave the impression that this was an inevitable evolution of mankind, that the world had reached an end point in the progression of socio-economic epochs. There was no need for large-scale conflict in a world with global trade, where freedom and democracy were ultimately forthcoming. This idea was known to many as the end of history.
Tomorrow. You guys with the World Trade Organization?
Yeah.
Yeah?
Well, I think people will start to realize how important trade is. A lot of people are ignorant, too.
Well, yeah, that's true. But, you know, it's not like World Trade Organization knows it all. You gotta listen.
I've been working on this for 28 years.
Yeah.
I know it very well.
What have you been working on?
International trade for 28 years. It started with after the war, because the failure to understand the importance of trade helped to cause World War II. Brought Hitler to power. And it was after World War II that people said, that can't happen again.
People are feeling like it is happening again in this country.
What is happening again?
Fascism.
Oh. So,
with the great power struggles ended, the world dreamed of peace and universal prosperity. This optimism created a euphoria so strong that it led to the biggest strategic blunder of the modern age.
Britain's best interests are served by suspending our membership of the exchange rate mechanism.
Lamont on the line. Pound looks likely to be devalued.
Home loans nightmare. The base rates to return to 12%.
The Chinese missile tests and military exercises have sent a blunt message across the strait. Taiwanese independence is not an option. China will use force if necessary to stop it. In Chinese schools these days, Taiwan is the topic in every political and history class.
The scenes from Hong Kong's handover from Britain to China.
There's nothing short of breathtaking, a points drop never before seen on the US markets. This closing bell might as well have been an alarm, so savage was the selling. NASDAQ index in freefall, down nearly 10%.
Quarter sales will be about 5% below the year-ago level.
This just in, you were looking at obviously a very disturbing live shot there. That is the World Trade Center, and we have unconfirmed reports this morning that a plane has crashed into one of the towers.
America strikes back. Afghanistan is pounded with bombs and missiles from the air and sea.
We are supported by the collective will of the world.
The first wave, 50 Tomahawk cruise missiles like these, fired from U.S. and British ships and submarines. B-52s, B-1s, and these two B-2 stealth bombers. The most immediate objective, to disarm and disable the Taliban military, to permit opposition groups to take control. That would make it safer then for U.S. special forces to hunt down and root out Osama bin Laden and his terrorist cells.
From CBS News headquarters in New York, here is Dan Rather.
It was just over 90 minutes beyond President Bush's deadline for Saddam Hussein to leave Iraq that U.S. warships and planes, there were F-117 stealth bombers involved, launched the opening salvo of Operation Iraqi Freedom.
Extraordinary explosive capability launched from B-52s, perhaps as many as 10 from the United Kingdom, and then sea-launched missiles from submarines.
The President's package is, from my perspective, what the doctor ordered. It is exactly right for investors, which is important now to our economy, since most of America is now invested in the market, having consumer confidence go up because of your portfolios going up and spending going up. All are now tied together.
If we have a national debt of $6 trillion, it would be interesting to know who we owe. It's growing $1.6 billion a day. To whom do the citizens of the United States of America owe $7 trillion?
Communism had not yet fallen. After the Second World War, the Soviet Union supported the communist revolution in China. But it was an uneasy alliance. By the early 1960s, communist leaders in China felt that reforms in the Soviet Union were straying too far from Marxist ideology. China criticized the policy of peaceful coexistence with the capitalist West as a betrayal of the communist cause, even though China would eventually adopt similar policies and reforms. Tensions between the two communist domains boiled over into a small but armed conflict in 1969, near the height of the Vietnam War. This prompted the United States to seek diplomatic relations with China, which gradually improved throughout the 70s, 80s, and 90s. Under a push by President Clinton, China was given permanent normal trade relations in 2000. Paving the way for China's entrance into the World Trade Organization in 2001.
For me, there is only one direction forward on trade, and that is to go on with what we're doing, recognizing that this is a new and very different world, but the idea that we would be better off with less trade, with less rule-based trade, by turning away from our attempts to find international ways within which we can work together, I think is dead wrong. Now, having said that, what does that mean? Well, for me, it meant that when first our neighbors in Mexico and then our friends in Asia were in turmoil and crisis, the United States had to keep our markets open, even though it led to record trade deficits. For me, it means it's very important to get China into the World Trade Organization, to ensure that China's markets are open to us, even as we have our markets open to China, and to advance peace and stability in Asia and increase the possibility of positive change in China.
Western academics, business leaders, and policymakers thought that deepening trade relations with China would open China's vast markets to Western companies. Some speculated that it might drive reforms, pushing China towards liberal democracy. The actual result was the greatest technology transfer in history. American companies lured into China's markets found technology transfer as the price of entry. Under joint venture structures, foreign companies entering China were often required to make equity ventures with their competitors. China used these concessions to plunder foreign intellectual property at an unprecedented scale. In 1991, China accounted for 1% of total imports to the United States. By 2003, 12.5%, with China making up less than 4% of U.S. exports. The four highest import categories were all technology-related. China became the linchpin of low-price strategies. This caused structural asymmetries in the U.S. economy. In 2008, the foundation began to shake.
2-year note yields went from 190 to 166 in the blink of an eye.
Let's talk about the speed with which we are watching this market deteriorate.
A lot of their customers are freaked out, waiting to see how low the Dow will go. They're focused on the Dow, not so focused on OPEC. Yes, OPEC did cut production by 1.5 million barrels.
You're going to have, that's going to cause Armageddon.
No, we have Armageddon. I wouldn't try to cause this. We have Armageddon.
I have talked to the heads of almost every single one of these firms in the last 72 hours, and he has no idea what it's like out there. None! And Bill Poole has no idea what it's like out there. My people have been in this game for 25 years, and they are losing their jobs, and these firms are going to go out of business, and he's nuts. They're nuts. They know nothing.
I know many Americans have questions tonight. How did we reach this point in our economy? How will the solution I propose work? And what does this mean for your financial future? These are good questions, and they deserve clear answers.
Well, the Chinese premier is right. It all started in the United States. And I think it happened for a number of reasons. I think the approximate cause, obviously, was the failure in the subprime mortgage market and the securities that were issued out of it and the derivatives that were issued out of them. But there was, in general, too much leverage and a lot of our financing, and the risk analysis was too loose and the regulation was too poor. But in addition to that, I think it's important to recognize that in 2001, when the high-tech bubble burst in America, we had lots of money sloshing around in our country, and the Federal Reserve tried to keep interest rates low to minimize the length of the recession, which they did. But America had no real economic strategy for creating new jobs, new businesses, and new sectors. So all the job growth in our country was in housing, finance, and consumer spending. So not surprisingly, we put too much money into housing, and then people found interesting financial mechanisms out of that, and the American people maxed out their credit cards, and we went down the road which led to all the other things. So if we have to sell treasury notes to foreigners now, which we have to do because we doubled the debt of America in the last 8 years with a policy that those of you who are Americans know I strongly opposed. Other countries have to finance
this recovery, but it's good for them because we can't buy exports until we grow again.
In the aftermath of the 2008 financial crisis, China and Russia called for the US dollar to be replaced with a new international world currency.
Calls to reform the International Monetary Fund have gathered momentum since the global financial crisis began. China wants the creation of a new currency to eventually replace the US dollar as the global benchmark.
Now, as G8 leaders prepare to meet this week, Russian President Dmitry Medvedev is repeating his call for a new international reserve currency.
There's going to be a long debate as to whether the US dollars will be able to still, as before, as a dominant currency. So we shall see.
Got a lot of questions just about the investing in China risks, and I'll ask this one from Ravi Mehta. He's interested in your take on China and Chinese stock exposure for the long term. He says it's becoming quite evident that Chinese companies could be banned from doing business in the Western world or maybe some of the Eastern countries too because of the number of the following reasons. One, the security threat issues. Two, the potential conflict over Taiwan. Three, inability to meet Western accounting standards. And number four, human rights issues. Considering all of the risks mentioned above, why would anyone as smart as Munger or Buffett consider investing in China or any of the Chinese companies?
Well, we did it for a very simple reason. We got more strength per dollar invested in China. The companies we invest in are stronger relative to their competition and priced lower. That's why we're in China.
This one came in from Wasim. He said, although the financials seem strong, do the political pressures from the Chinese government worry you at all?
Well, the Chinese government is worrying all the capitalists in the world way more than it used to. And of course we don't like that. And we wish that China and the United States got along better. And if you stop to think about it, think of how massively stupid both China and the United States have been to allow the existing tensions to arise. What bad is ever going to happen to China or the United States if we two are close? If we make good friends out of the Chinese and vice versa, who in the hell is ever going to bother us? Of course we should make friends with China. And of course we should learn to get along with people who have a different system of government. We like our government because we're used to it and it has advantages of personal freedom. China could never have handled its life with a government like ours. They wouldn't be in the position they're in. They had to prevent 500 million or 600 million people from being born in China. They just measured the women's menstrual periods when they came to work and aborted those who weren't allowed to have children. You can't do that in the United States, and it really needed doing in China. And so they did what they had to do using their methods. And I don't think we should be criticizing China, which has terrible problems because they're not just like the United States. They do some things better than we do. They should like us and we should like them. So I think nothing is crazier than people who foment resentments on either side of that one.
Another shareholder named Lee, L-I, wrote in and said, how do you think the Ukraine situation will be resolved in your opinion?
In post-Soviet Russia, a new force had risen. For over two decades, Vladimir Putin has ruled Russia, steadily gaining more control. Before becoming a political figure, Putin was a lieutenant colonel in the KGB. In the KGB, he was allegedly assigned to support the Red Army faction, a terrorist group whose objective was to destabilize West Germany. Many of Russia's top officials are also former KGB operatives. As a child, Putin was an avid reader of Marxist ideology. His father served in the Soviet Navy for military forces and was wounded in the army. His grandfather was a personal cook to Joseph Stalin. Putin's rise to power marked Russia's shift away from reform and democracy, a reversal of the progress made by Boris Yeltsin.
I indeed said that I believe that the collapse of the USSR was a huge tragedy of the 20th century. You know why? Because first of all, in a single instant, 25 million Russian people found themselves beyond the borders of the Russian Federation.
Some have speculated that Putin was behind the bombings of Russian apartment complexes, the first of a series of terrorist attacks, and a war in Chechnya that allowed Putin to consolidate power. Claiming it was in the interest of national security, Putin canceled elections and silenced critics. Yeltsin had once hoped Russia will join NATO. Putin took matters in a radically different direction.
Before Boris Yeltsin died, he told intimates that it was a great mistake for him to have selected Putin as his successor.
With a rising China, this was in the middle of an East and West power struggle. At the 2007 Munich Security Conference, Putin criticized U.S. power and the role of Western leadership in world affairs.
Only two decades ago, the world was ideologically and economically divided. And it was the huge strategic potential of two superpowers that ensured global security. This global standoff pushed the sharpest economic and social problems to the margins of the international communities and the world's agenda. And just like any war, the Cold War left us with live ammunition, figuratively speaking. I'm referring to ideological stereotypes, double standards, and other typical aspects of Cold War bloc thinking. The unipolar world that had been proposed after the Cold War did not take place either. The history of humanity certainly has gone through unipolar periods and seen aspirations to world supremacy and what hasn't happened in world history. However, what is a unipolar world? However one might embellish this term, at the end of the day, it refers to one type of situation, namely one center of authority, one center of force, one center of decision-making. It is a world in which there is one master, one sovereign, and at the end of the day, this is promiscuous not only for those within this system, but also for the sovereign itself, because it destroys itself from within. And independent legal norms are, as a matter of fact, coming increasingly closer to one state's legal system. One state, and of course, first and foremost, the United States, has overstepped its national borders in every way. This is visible in the economic, political, cultural, and educational policies it imposes on other nations. Well, who likes this? Who is happy about this? Madam Federal Chancellor already mentioned this. The combined GDP, measured in purchasing power parity of countries such as India and China, is already greater than that of the United States, and a similar calculation with the GDP of the BRIC countries. Brazil, Russia, India, and China surpasses the cumulative GDP of the EU. And according to experts, this gap will only increase in the future. There is no reason to doubt that the economic potential of the new centers of global economic growth will inevitably be converted into political influence and will strengthen multipolarity. I consider that the unipolar model, is not only unacceptable, but also impossible in today's world.
Putin argued in favor of a world where the United States, China, and Russia would each have their own sphere of influence, as opposed to a world led solely by a progression towards Western values. In the East, Putin sought closer relations with China. In the West, Putin sought to halt the expansion of NATO. After the fall of the Soviet Union, many former members of the Communist bloc joined with NATO, aligning their interests with the West. In a prelude to what would come in Ukraine, Russia invaded parts of Georgia in 2008, which are still occupied today. The invasion came 5 years after a political revolution that pushed Georgia towards greater integration with Europe. Taking advantage of Georgia's strategic location, the US and EU backed the creation of an oil pipeline that circumvented Russia's purview over the Caspian Sea. In response to Georgia's NATO aspirations and closer ties with the West, Russia stoked ethnic tensions, armed separatist militias, and conducted a brutal bombing campaign.
How hard we push to back up Vice President Cheney's words that this will not go unanswered, because I believe it will go unanswered militarily. But we still have a lot of economic and diplomatic steps, including perhaps John McCain's idea of trying to kick Russia out of the G8, or even now there's some talk of boycotting the Olympics in Russia.
Ukraine became the front line in the power struggle between East and West. After declaring independence from the Soviet Union in 1991, Ukraine became Europe's seventh largest country, with a population nearly the size of Spain. Ukraine is an industrialized nation that primarily exports metals, machinery, and agricultural products. Along its Russian border, Ukraine is a primary conduit for Russian oil and gas pipelines connecting to Western Europe. Over half of Russian gas exported to the EU passes through Ukraine. In late 2013, under pressure from the Kremlin, Ukrainian President Viktor Yanukovych abruptly backed away from an agreement to put Ukraine on a pathway to EU membership. The agreement included a number of reforms and establishment of political and economic association. Putin claimed the deal would hurt Russia's security interests and started a trade war with Ukraine. The surprise refusal triggered mass protests that escalated into a revolution.
People of Ukraine, this is your moment.
Народи українські, це ваш момент.
This is about you, no one else.
Це про вас.
This is about the future you want for your country. This is about the future you deserve. A future in Europe.
Майбутнє Європи.
A future of peace.
Майбутнє миру.
Good relations with all of your neighbors.
Майбутнє всіх ваших сусідів.
The free world is with you. America is with you. I am with you. And the destiny you seek lies in Europe.
І ваша доля, як ми вважаємо, знаходиться в об'єднаній Європі.
Ukraine will make Europe better, and Europe will make Ukraine better.
Thank you, thank you.
And I'm looking forward to meeting with our opposition leaders tonight and tomorrow in the square. And I'm proud of the people of Ukraine and their steadfast efforts for democracy for their country.
Thank you. throughout this crisis, we have been very clear about one fundamental principle. The Ukrainian people deserve the opportunity to determine their own future.
The protests lasted for 3 months. The protesters toppled the Ukrainian government, and the agreement was signed. Yanukovych fled Ukraine with the help of the Russian military. In response to this triumph, Russia orchestrated a covert takeover of the Crimean Peninsula, annexing part of Ukraine.
I admire the fact that you will fight for your homeland. Your fight is our fight. 2017 will be the year of offense. All of us will go back to Washington and we will push the case against Russia. Enough of a Russian aggression. It is time for them to pay a heavier price. Our fight is not with the Russian people, but with Putin. Our promise to you is to take your cause to Washington.
Наша обіцянка це те, що ми вашу боротьбу доведемо до Вашингтона.
Inform the American people of your bravery.
Проінформуємо американський народ про вашу відважність.
And make the case against Putin to the world.
І покажемо про докази проти Путіна всьому світу.
I believe you will win. I am convinced you will win, and we will do everything we can to provide you with what you need to win.
Я вірю в те, що ви виграєте, переможете. Я переконаний в тому, що ви переможете, і ми вам допоможемо всіма можливими засобами.
And we have succeeded not because of equipment, but because of your courage.
Ви успішні не через обладнання, але через вашу відважність.
So I thank you, and the world is watching. And the world is watching. Because we cannot allow Vladimir Putin to succeed here. Because if he succeeds here, he will succeed in other countries.
Я вам дуже дякую, і весь світ за цим слідкує. І весь цим світ за цим слідкує, тому що ми не можемо дозволити Володимиру Путіну тут перемогти.
Good afternoon, everyone. It's a great pleasure to be once more here in Kyiv. To reaffirm the depth of the partnership between our two peoples. This is my sixth visit to Ukraine as Vice President, and my fifth in the year since the Revolution of Dignity on the Maidan, which was an astounding thing to witness.
The United States is with you in this fight. We understand we're with you afar. It's much harder for you than it is for us. We've stepped up with official assistance to help backstop the Ukrainian economy. We've rallied the international community to commit a total of $25 billion in bilateral and multilateral financing to support Ukraine. It includes $2 billion in U.S. loan guarantees and the possibility of more. Yesterday, I announced almost $190 million in new American assistance to help Ukraine fight corruption, strengthen the rule of law, implement critical reforms, bolster civil society, advance energy security. That brings our total of direct aid to almost $760 million in direct assistance and additional loan guarantees since this crisis broke out. And that is not the end of what we're prepared to do if you keep moving.
At times, U.S. involvement in Ukraine gave the appearance of stoking Ukraine's notorious corruption. At the same time, Vice President Biden was working closely with Ukraine's new government. His son, Hunter Biden, on the board of Ukrainian natural gas producer, Vesma Holdings. Despite being a drug addict with no experience in the energy industry, Hunter Biden received compensation in excess of $50,000 a month. Vesma Holdings was investigated by the United Kingdom for money laundering. When the Ukrainian Prosecutor General's office failed to provide documents to British authorities, many called for the prosecutor to be removed. This prompted Vice President Biden to threaten the withholding of aid to Ukraine.
I said, you're not getting the billion, I'm gonna be leaving here. And I think it was, what, 6 hours? I looked, I said, I'm leaving in 6 hours. If the prosecutor's not fired, you're not getting the money. Well, son of a bitch, got fired.
That means that there is a new government and a new prosecutor general. I am prepared to do a public signing of the commitment for the $1 billion.
I'm a man of my word. And that now that the new prosecutor general's in place, we're ready to move forward in signing that new $1 billion loan guarantee.
Though nothing was proven, the fact that Vice President Biden pushed the Ukrainian government to fire a prosecutor investigating a company his son was representing created many suspicions.
Did you and your father ever discuss Ukraine?
No. As I said, the only time was after a news account, and it wasn't a discussion in any way. There's no but to this. No, we never did.
And I remember looking at Jim Biden and saying, how are you guys getting away with this? Like, aren't you concerned? And he sort of looked at me and he laughed a little bit and said, plausible deniability.
He said that out loud?
Yes, he said it directly to me, one-on-one in a cabana at the Peninsula Hotel.
In addition, you also have a battle, a historic battle against corruption. Corruption siphons away resources from the people, it blunts the economic growth, and it affronts the human dignity.
Another source of controversy was the Azov Battalion. Azov started out as an all-volunteer militia in 2014 that formed in response to a civil war that began in Ukraine's Donbas region, sparked by Russia's invasion of Crimea. Their tenacity in combat played a critical role in retaking Mariupol from the Russian-backed separatists. As a result, they were formally integrated into the Ukrainian military as a special detachment. Their training by the U.S. military faced significant debate in Congress. Azov's controversy came from its idolizing of neo-Nazi imagery. Some of its members claimed to be neo-Nazis. Yet the nuance is complex. Azov accepts Jewish members. Ukrainian President Volodymyr Zelensky is also Jewish. The founder of Azov said once that Israel is a role model for the future of Ukraine. But Azov's Nazi imagery would ultimately fuel Russian propaganda, with Putin citing denazification as a key reason for invading Ukraine.
Похоже, нам з вами будет легче договориться, чем с этой шайкой наркоманов и неонацистов, которая засела в Киеве и взяла в заложники весь украинский народ.
В очередь полиция попросила нас проконтролировать точки кредитирования, на которые в последнее время часто начали, на которых часто начали случаться разбои. Вот. И уже косвенно мы контролируем вообще ситуацию на улице, то есть пытаемся выявить какие-то правонарушения.
Killer, bass is loaded. Zeke on first, Santana on second, Jim on third.
Yeah,
I'm at bat. We about to hit this shit out the
world. Whoa.
Killer, beatmakers, clap, clap. Say.
Back in the United States, the election of Donald Trump came with a new approach to relations with Russia. In many ways, the Trump presidency was the anti-WTO movement of the 1990s come full circle.
What you have is a faceless government who's making international decisions to determine what the workplace is going to be about, what trade is going to be about, and they right now are making decisions in favor of the multinational corporations, and the little people are getting left on the cutting room floor.
We stared down the unholy alliance of lobbyists and donors and special interests who made a living bleeding our country dry. That's what we've done. We broke down the doors of Washington back rooms where deals were cut to close our companies, give away your jobs, shut down our factories, and surrender your sovereignty and your very way of life. And we've ended it.
Trump recognized that American foreign policy was failing on two fronts. Sanctions had failed to stop Russia's aggression. More importantly, modern Russia is a far cry from the days of the Soviet Union, when the communist bloc controlled 20% of the world economy. Today, Russia's share of global GDP is approximately 3%. Adjusted to U.S. dollars, the average Russian household makes less than $7,000 a year. Policy towards China had also failed.
Well, the Chinese president also met with Klaus Schwab, the founder and executive chairman of the World Economic Forum, on the sidelines of this year's annual meeting in Davos, Switzerland. Schwab earlier said Xi's presence was a sign of the shift from a unipolar world dominated by the United States to a more multipolar system in which rising powers like China will have a step up and play a bigger role. Before Xi delivered his keynote speech, Schwab said, in a world marked by great uncertainty and volatility, the world is looking to China.
We cannot have free and open trade if some countries exploit the system at the expense of others. We support free trade, but it needs to be fair and it needs to be reciprocal, because in the end, unfair trade undermines us all. And this is just the beginning. Many nations in this hall will agree that the world trading system is in dire need of change. For example, countries were admitted to the World Trade Organization that violate every single principle on which the organization is based. While the United States and many other nations play by the rules, these countries use government-run industrial planning and state-owned enterprises to rig the system in their favor. They engage in relentless product dumping, forced technology transfer, and the theft of intellectual property. The United States lost over 3 million manufacturing jobs, nearly a quarter of all steel jobs, and 60,000 factories after China joined the WTO. And we have racked up $13 trillion in trade deficits over the last two decades. But those days are over. We will no longer tolerate such abuse. We will not allow our workers to be victimized, our companies to be cheated, and our wealth to be plundered and transferred. America will never apologize for protecting its citizens.
Tough sanctions on Russia for the invasion of Crimea pushed Russia into closer partnership with China. Trump attempted to pivot U.S. policy and create warmer relations with Xi.
We're going to have a great relationship with China. We're going to have a great relationship with Putin and Russia. But let me tell you, China... We'll be talking a little bit about China. Our mutual friend, President Xi, that getting along with Russia is a good thing, not a bad thing.
But this backfired politically. Trump's political opponents spent most of his presidency accusing him of colluding with Russia.
President Trump obviously seemed frightened in the presence of Putin. What was he afraid of? What is Putin blackmailing President Trump with? Putin appears to be President Trump's puppeteer.
The Russians offered help. The campaign accepted help. The Russians gave help, and the president made full use of that help. And that is pretty damning.
Our national security has been jeopardized by his attitude toward Putin. He's put Putin on a pedestal. He's questioned Article 5 of NATO. He has flirted with the idea of not enforcing or expanding any sanctions against Russia in terms of their aggressive military behavior in Europe.
I think there's plenty of evidence of collusion or conspiracy in plain sight. There is significant evidence, much of it in the public domain, on the issue of collusion.
The fact is that I've gone head to head with Putin and made it clear to him we're not going to take any of his stuff. He's Putin's puppy. He still refuses to even say anything to Putin about the bounty on the heads of American soldiers.
Your son got $3.5 million.
And by the way,
Mr. President, wait a minute. Mr. President, your campaign agreed.
I never saw any direct empirical evidence that the Trump campaign or someone in it was plotting or conspiring with the Russians to meddle with the election. End quote. Compare that to his Twitter feed.
In the end, partisan politics played into China's hands. After three decades of U.S.-China integration, Trump's policies were deeply unpopular in the corporate, financial, and lobbyist communities.
那么我们为什么搞不定特朗普政府？为什么以前1992年到2016年之间，中美之间各种问题都能搞得定？ 是不是？大家发现没有？所有的危机，不管是银河号事件还是炸大使馆，还是撞了飞机，所有事情全部是床头吵架床尾和两个月之内搞定。什么原因？这儿我抛出一个可能又要是暴论了，就是因为咱们上边有人，就是我们在美国的权势核心圈，我们有我们的老朋友，大家明白我意思吧？懂得掌声。好。 那么其实呢，就是说说的白了点儿，其实呢就过去这个30年过去40年，我们在美国的他的这个利用他权势核心圈，是不是？我前面讲过，华尔街在1970年代开始对美国它的内政外交有非常强的影响力，所以我们有路径依赖，是吧？但问题是08年之后华尔街的地位下降了，更重要的是16年之后。 华尔街搞不定特朗普，为什么？很尴尬，特朗普以前对华尔街有过一次软性违约，所以双方有矛盾。当然这个细节我就不多说了，时间可能已经来不及了，是吧？那么这个中美贸易战过程中，他们也试图帮忙，据我所知，美方的朋友跟我讲，这个试图帮忙，但是利有不逮。但现在呢，现在我们看到拜登上台了。<笑> 传统的精英政治精英，这个建制派，他们跟华尔街的关系是非常密切的。所以大家看到吧，拜登的儿子被特朗普说你在全球有什么基金公司，发现没有？谁帮他建的基金公司啊？明白吗？这个都有买卖。所以这个时候我们。
Russia's invasion was for more than a territorial dispute. It was a challenge of the U.S.-led global order. A series of four events leading up to the war in Ukraine gave the impression that U.S. power was crumbling. This appearance of weakness caused Russia to miscalculate the outcome of the conflict, grossly underestimating the resilience of the U.S. and its allies. The first was the COVID pandemic, which originated during the 2019 Wuhan military games, attended by many NATO countries. The virus originated in close proximity to a virology lab that was experimenting on coronaviruses, leading many to suspect that the virus was of unnatural origin. While China was able to control the spread of the virus with draconian measures, The Western world was thrown into economic crisis. The second, mass unrest surrounding the murder of George Floyd at the hands of a police officer and former co-worker. George Floyd was no civil rights leader. He had 9 previous arrests. He was a part-time rapper, a major porn star, and was on fentanyl at the time of his death. In 2007, Floyd and 5 others broke into an apartment where Floyd held a woman at gunpoint. The third event was the January 6th riot. Many of Trump's supporters refused to believe that Biden legitimately received more votes than any other candidate in history. Despite covering just 17% of all counties, but less than Barack Obama in 2008 and 2012. The U.S. has a long history of unruly demonstrations on the U.S. Capitol. But the frenetic political rhetoric gave the impression that the United States had swung from a potential left-wing revolution to a right-wing coup attempt over the course of 6 months.
Yesterday, McChrystal took a break from collecting fat corporate directors' fees to note that, based on his extensive experience mismanaging America's foreign policy, Trump voters look an awful lot like terrorists, an awful lot. Quote, I did see a similar dynamic in the evolution of Al-Qaeda in Iraq, McChrystal said, where a whole generation of angry Arab youth with very poor prospects followed a powerful leader who promised to take them back to a time to a better place, and he led them to embrace an ideology that justified their violence. This is now happening in America. Al-Qaeda in America. Thanks, Stan. Sometime when you can manage to spare a moment from getting rich from your failures in America's decline, we'd love to know exactly what did happen in Afghanistan. What went wrong there, when you have time?
Finally, the fourth. Despite assurances from U.S. military leadership that the situation in Afghanistan was stable, the withdrawal by U.S. forces resulted in a spectacular collapse. Afghanistan fell into the hands of the Taliban, while the U.S. military conducted a chaotic evacuation. These four events gave the perception that the U.S. is geopolitically unstable, that the global order is being underpinned by a rapidly declining power.
На происходящее в ряде западных стран мы с изумлением узнаем отечественные практики, которые сами, к счастью, оставили, надеюсь, в далеком прошлом. Борьба за равноправие и против дискриминации превращается в агрессивный догматизм на грани абсурда, когда великих авторов прошлого, того же Шекспира, перестают преподавать в школах.
Есть, знаете, вот эта современная, так называемая либеральная идея, да?
In the months following, there had been a massive troop buildup on the Ukrainian border. By November, Russia had moved over 70,000 troops within proximity of Ukraine. By mid-January, Russia had fielded well over 100,000 troops, with more arriving daily.
Washington has placed more than 8,000 US-based troops on a heightened state of alert, and NATO is sending more warships and fighter jets to member states in Eastern Europe. Now, tension in the region has been building, with around 100,000 Russian troops massed near Ukraine's borders.
Fears of an invasion began to mount. The US began daily reconnaissance flights over Ukraine, the Black Sea, Poland, and Lithuania. These flights became increasingly aggressive, including the circling of Kaliningrad. Recon missions were conducted by C-135s, conducting signals intelligence. J-STARS, capable of mapping ground targets. Experimental spy planes, disguised as private jets. And a high-altitude global hawk drone, known as call sign 4J12. that regularly conducted patrols just outside of hostile airspace. Information collected from these missions gave the Ukrainians significant tactical advantages, leveraging the training they received from NATO. The U.S. also began delivering what it referred to as lethal aid, arming Ukraine with missiles and anti-tank weapons. Along the Ukrainian periphery, forces from allied NATO countries began arriving in Estonia, Latvia, Lithuania, Poland, and Romania. In Norway, the U.S. Marine Corps activated secretive for positioned assets hidden in Norwegian caves.
Russian forces are ramping up intense war games in the region, signaling both sides are preparing for possible conflict. This comes as Russia is striking down suggestions of a diplomatic breakthrough.
Russia will be held accountable if it invades, and it depends on what it does. It's one thing if it's a minor incursion and then we end up having a fight about what to do and not do, etc. But if they actually do what they're capable of doing with the force amassed on the border, it is going to be a disaster for Russia.
Escalation conflict. Да, да. Как вы думаете, возможно война или нет?
Да, я думаю, нет. Это уже длится, знаете, сколько пугает Украину.
If you run the number, like, there is no fucking chance they do anything.
Я думаю, что вряд ли. Так могут поврязкать,
I think it won't happen soon. It won't happen.
On the opening day of the 2022 Winter Olympics, Russia and China announced a new, no limits, partnership. China supported Russia's demand that Ukraine be barred from joining NATO and called for an end to NATO expansion.
As the Winter Olympics got underway in Beijing, President Putin of Russia was the star guest, meeting President Xi Jinping before the official opening. China and Russia announced a new partnership, with China saying it'll back Russia's foreign policy aims and saying it supports Russian demands that NATO halt its expansion. That is seen as an implicit reference to the situation in Ukraine. Mr. Putin hailed the agreement as an unprecedented pact of cooperation.
China also announced a new deal to buy oil and gas from Russia's state-backed energy firms. At the same time that China was teaming up with Russia in a thinly veiled challenge to U.S. power, the U.S. was sharing key details of what its potential response would be in the event of a Russian invasion of Ukraine. China reportedly shared this information with Russia. Russia continued to amass troops, reaching over 150,000 by mid-February. At the Munich Security Conference, where 15 years earlier Putin had lashed out against US leadership, the mood was dismissive.
Everyone is saying there is some distance that we need to go between Ukraine and the NATO, that we need to walk. All we are saying is, tell us, how much time does it take to complete this distance, measured in years? And you see this is measured not just in hours, and you can see with the tragedies and lives. This is measured in the human life of Ukrainians. So tell us, on this distance, is it fair for us to get the guarantees while we're still walking this path, some diplomatic guarantees? Isn't it just simply fair? No one is pushing anyone against the wall with a question for us to be there in the NATO. That's not the case. We want to, we do, but until we have that possibility, what we want is the guarantees, security guarantees.
And I know you have to go, I'm getting the old rap, but can I ask you...
Just a second, I think cyber attack. Can I have another one for translation? Yes.
But maybe you
see, Russia's not here, but they're here. It doesn't work. I'm sorry.
How about if I try to talk to you and you'll understand me?
I understand you from the very beginning, but you know, there are some very important things.
Yeah. So what I want to ask you, Mr. President, is that the U.S. has its intelligence. You said you have yours. What is your interpretation of Putin's intention? Not his capability, his intention. Do you think that he will invade? He will decide to do that? Or he has?
I don't know what the president of Russian Federation wants. That's why I propose to meet.
That's it.
On that note,
your people are telling me that. I mean, listen, guys. We're talking about the potential for war in Europe. I mean, let's really take a moment to understand the significance of what we're talking about.
We get a break in either one of these, inflation or Russian aggression, then you're going to get a snapback rally of epic proportions. The kind of rally we haven't seen since 2020, when the kids stopped playing Call of Duty and started day trading.
Russian troops failed to return home after their exercises ended. Instead, thousands more arrived. Though the U.S. continued diplomatic efforts, it became obvious that an invasion was imminent, and Russia was merely stalling for time.
Country, because we can see how consistently they are pumping Ukraine with weapons. The United States alone, starting from 2014, transferred billions of dollars, including the arms supply, training, personnel. In recent months, Western weapons are sent to Ukraine ceaselessly in front of the eyes of the entire world. The activities of the Ukrainian army is governed by the foreign consultants, and we are well aware of that. Last year, under the pretext of the war games, the military contingents of the NATO countries were deployed in Ukraine. The Ukrainian army is already integrated into NATO. It means that Ukrainian units, Ukrainian army units, can be done directly from the NATO headquarters. The West started to explore the territory of Ukraine as the future theater of military action, as the future battlefield, and it is aimed against Russia. Last year alone, it had more than 20,000 troops and more than 1,000 equipment, hardware units. You only need to look at the map to see how did the Western countries keep their word about non-expansion of NATO eastwards. They just lied to us. We had five waves of NATO expansion. In 1999, Poland, Czech Republic, Hungary were joined NATO. In 2004, Bulgaria, Estonia, Lithuania, Slovakia, Romania, and Slovenia. In 2009, Albania and Croatia. In 2017, Montenegro. And 2020, North Macedonia. As a result, the alliance, its military infrastructure, is drawn really close to the borders of Russia. And who is the main adversary of the United States? We all know that, Russia. In NATO documents, our country is officially directly called a main threat to the North Atlantic security. And Ukraine will serve as the platform for such an offense. I deem it necessary to make a decision that should have been made long time ago, to immediately recognize the independence and sovereignty of Donetsk People's Republic and Lugansk People's Republic.
In the parts of Ukraine that Russia declared to be independent states, the celebrations were small.
Russian President Vladimir Putin ordering his troops to move into eastern Ukraine in a major and dangerous escalation.
Putin announcing he's sending so-called peacekeepers into breakaway regions of Ukraine controlled by pro-Russian rebels. It comes after he recognized their independence from Ukraine today in a highly provocative move. These are Moscow-backed separatists who have been fighting Ukraine's military for 8 years now. In a fiery speech that was broadcast across Russia and the world, Putin demanded and warned Ukraine to cease all combat operations against the rebels. Otherwise, Putin said, the responsibility for continuing the bloodshed will lay on the shoulders of the Ukrainian regime. Putin also essentially laid claim to Ukraine. He said, Ukraine is not just a neighboring country, it's an integral part of our history, culture. Modern Ukraine was entirely created by Russia, by Bolshevik communist Russia, to be exact.
Stan, I'm pleased to be joined by U.S. Secretary of State Antony Blinken. Mr. Secretary, thank you for being here. Do you have reason to believe that before this night is over, Russian forces will be engaged in something akin to a full invasion of Ukraine?
I do. Unfortunately, Russia has positioned its forces at the final point of readiness across Ukraine's borders, to the north, to the east, to the south. Everything seems to be in place for Russia to engage in a major aggression against Ukraine.
Седьмой устава ООН, санкции Совета Федерации России и выполнение ратифицированных Федеральным собранием 22 февраля сего года договоров о дружбе и взаимопомощи с Донецкой Народной Республикой и Луганской Народной Республикой. Мною принято решение о проведении специальной военной операции. Ее цель – защита людей, которые на протяжении 8 лет подвергаются издевательствам, геноциду со стороны киевского режима. И для этого мы будем стремиться к демилитаризации и денацификации Украины,
а также предаю суду тех, кто совершил многочисленные кровавые преступления против мирных жителей, в том числе и граждан Российской Федерации.
Connecting you. Please hold the line.
NORAD. EWS. Attention. Attention. Status alert CON 4. Status alert CON 4.
All stations. All stations. This is Woodland. Woodland. Four upper crust.
Заявленные страны подтвердили открытие воздушных пистолетов.
Thank you.
Собаки, пришедшие на нашу землю.
As the sun rose over Ukraine, the world got its first look at modern war.
Де? На Вінниці.
Russia has declared war on Ukraine. That as soon as the declaration.
There you go.
Oh, fuck! That's a missile! That's a missile!
Сбор денег снова.
Чув, я не бачу.
Russian soldiers marked their vehicles to distinguish them from the Ukrainian units. They were divided in groups based on their area of operations. C for the south and coastline of Ukraine, advancing from Crimea. C with a square for eastern Ukraine, advancing towards Kharkiv. V for units headed towards Kyiv from the north, east of the Dnieper River. O for units headed towards Kyiv, west of the Dnieper River. Opening hours of the war, Russian airborne forces launched an air assault on Hostomel port. Mostly used for cargo flights, this airport was uniquely equipped with large runways. It was home to the world's largest aircraft, the Antonov 225. Located a few miles outside of Kyiv, the Russians planned to use the airport as a staging area, from which the Russian military could quickly mount a decapitating strike on the Ukrainian government. The assault force included approximately 30 helicopters from the Russian VDV. ZDV planned to hold the airport and prepare for the arrival of infantry transports with reinforcements. They were unable to land. A rapid reaction brigade from the Ukrainian National Guard, armed civilians, and Ukrainian special forces surrounded the airport. Surrounded and unable to land reinforcements, the Russians received a major blow when Major General Andrei Sakovetsky was killed by a Ukrainian sniper. Ukrainian aircraft that survived the war's opening salvo drove the Russian VDV into the surrounding woods. The fighting continued for days. By the time the Russian mechanized column reached Hostomel, the airport was too damaged for practical use. The world's second largest army had suffered a strategic defeat. For Ukrainians, a boost in fighting spirit. In the south, Russian troops crossed the shallow lagoons separating Crimea from the rest of Ukraine, before pivoting towards the port city of Mariupol.
Russia launched an attack on neighboring Ukraine early Thursday. Ukraine's military said Russia began shelling Ukrainian forces in the country's east and carried out rocket strikes at airports in multiple cities across Ukraine. Ukraine's border guards also reported artillery attacks coming from Russia and from Belarus. Within hours of the missile attacks, Russian tanks rolled across Ukraine's borders from Russia, Belarus, and from Crimea, the Ukrainian peninsula Moscow annexed in 2014. Ukrainian officials said amphibious Russian forces landed near Odessa on the Black Sea. Intense rocket fire could also be heard in the eastern city of Kharkiv. Russian President Vladimir Putin announced the operation in a televised address Thursday. As the southern front pushed towards Mariupol, Russian naval infantry made an amphibious landing, securing a beachhead 40 miles west of the city, ahead of the advancing Russian army.
Ракетное оружие к бою. Peace on our continent has been shattered. We now have war in Europe on a scale and of a type we thought belonged to history.
President Putin has ordered Russia's strategic nuclear forces to be placed on high alert.
As Russia continues its advance on Ukraine, NATO may soon have more members. Finland and Sweden are considering applying to join.
Jens Stoltenberg said that Finland and Sweden should be allowed quick membership into the alliance should they ask for it.
Russia has warned that the entry of Finland and Sweden into NATO would lead to a militarization of the Baltic region.
Russia, public opinion was mixed.
I think if this is in the interests of Russia, then I support it, this man says.
И нет войне.
Точно нет войны.
Russian state media reported that Putin's approval rating rose to over 80%.
Мы многонациональный народ Российской Федерации, объединенные общей судьбой.
Уважаемые дамы и господа, более того, на днях Евросоюз в русофобском угаре принял решение поставлять Киеву летальные вооружения. Для нас...
Мариуполь!
In Ukraine, President Zelensky mobilized all reserve troops and issued a decree conscripting all Ukrainian males for military service. Anyone age 18 to 60 will be required to stand and fight.
Here. This is the short Kalashnikov.
They are in the process here in this section of making Molotov cocktails. You see them, they're taking styrofoam, they've sort of grated the styrofoam, and they're now putting it into the bottles. The styrofoam works to make the Molotov cocktail sticky.
Experts warn Ukraine will fall to Russia within days.
You're ready to fight, you're ready to use a gun.
At first, we were scared, really scared. But now, we are ready to fight. And like, fight like hell.
Ukraine also opened up its military to foreign volunteers.
Driving, right? So last Friday, my friend is in the jeep. He called me and said, "Okay, we really need you. Because you're next sniper, and can you join?" I said, "Yeah, okay, I'll do it."
When fascism rose in Spain, a lot of people went over, but not enough. If we'd have crushed fascism in 1936, we could have avoided 1939. That's what this feels like. If we don't stop it now, it's going to be our kids fighting this fight.
Russia failed to destroy Ukrainian communications in the opening strike. Having escaped destruction in the opening hours of the war, the Ukrainian Air Force was capable of providing much-needed air cover.
NATO is a one-phase trip, contact landing on frequency 11911, is all good.
NATO aircraft continued to fly support missions just outside of Ukrainian airspace. This limited Russia's ability to deploy strategic bombers, limiting them to cruise missile strikes launched outside of Ukrainian borders. Ukrainian jets intercepted Russian aircraft in air-to-air combat, with both sides flying a Su-27 and MiG-29 fighters on the Soviet road. Survival in the air was largely a mission of pilots still alone.
Pentagon has announced Ukraine has received fighter jets and aircraft parts to bolster its air force, but the type of plane has not been specified, nor have details of its delivery. Take a listen.
Masai has also deployed a Su-25 ground attack aircraft, though few in Ukraine's arsenal were airworthy at the start of the invasion.
And do you support a no-fly zone in Ukraine?
I support everything that has to do with punishing Vladimir Putin and helping the Ukrainians.
Wouldn't that mean direct conventional warfare with Russia?
I don't know what it will mean, but you know, freedom is not free.
So you don't know what a no-fly zone will mean? If you have to shoot down Russian planes, I mean.
Of course!
Failure to take hostile will give the Ukrainians time to prepare. Ordinary citizens took up arms and made improvised weapons and defenses. As the Russian army reached the outskirts of Kyiv, soldiers, militia, and civilians mounted fierce resistance.
Едете наверх.
Там вот и посадка, конечно.
Ведемо до розвідку.
Відходимо, відходимо! Валу! Валу! Далі! Валу! Фрайпорт сила! Отак от буває, коли приходиш на українську землю. Отак от буває.
Танк? Це був танк.
Yeah, buddy. One, two, three, four Russian tanks taken out. Call that a good day.
What are the hazards here?
The hazards are it's a high explosive. These are Javelin missiles.
Though NATO did not offer a no-fly zone, weapons and equipment provided by NATO members changed the course of the invasion. According to reports, NATO Contras have provided Ukraine with over 2,000 Stinger anti-aircraft missiles and over 5,000 Javelin anti-tank missiles.
What's
The Javelin anti-tank missile is easy to operate, highly portable, and automatically tracks targets. The Javelin's high explosive warhead is designed to explode directly over the top of a tank, where the armor is weakest. The 40-mile-long convoy of Russian vehicles headed towards Kyiv made easy targets. Ukraine also mounted a Darin-covered helicopter strike, destroying a fuel depot inside of Russia, 25 miles from the Ukrainian border. With supply lines cut, Russian vehicles often run out of fuel.
Сломались, пацаны. Сломались. Можно оттащить на Россию обратно. А вы хоть знаете, куда вы едете?
Much of the invasion force was made up of young conscripts. Russian citizens required to serve 1 year of mandatory military service after turning 18. Many abandoned their vehicles and surrendered to Ukraine.
That's an actual screenshot from someone who is dead already. Лёш,
Алёша,
ты как? Почему так долго не отвечаешь?
Why has it been so long since you responded?
Вы точно на учениях?
Are you really in training exercises?
Спрашивает мать убитого солдата.
Asks the mother of the killed soldier.
Моменты перед тем, как он был убит.
Before he was killed.
Мама, я уже не в Крыму.
Mama, I'm no longer in Crimea.
Не на учениях.
I'm not in training sessions.
А где?
Where are you then?
Папа спрашивает, можно
Papa
ли тебе
asking,
послать
whether I can
посылку.
Send you a parcel.
Так какую посылку,
what
мама?
What kind of a parcel, mama, can you send me?
Что ты говоришь такое?
What are you talking
Что случилось?
About? What happened?
Мама, я на
mama,
Украине.
I'm in Ukraine.
Тут настоящая
There
война.
There is a real war raging
Мне
here.
Мне страшно.
I'm afraid.
With Ukraine issuing a decree conscripting most men into military service, and so much of the population armed and ready to fight, it became difficult to discern innocent civilian from militia.
God's sake, this man cannot remain power.
Members of Congress, I have the high privilege and distinct honor of presenting to you the President of Ukraine, Volodymyr Zelensky. Slava Ukraina! Slava Ukraina!
And last night, President Biden said, we're going to seize their yachts.
The United States Department of Justice is assembling a dedicated task force to go after the crimes of the Russian oligarchs. We're joining with European allies to find and seize their yachts, their luxury apartments, their private jets.
A fiscal punishment intended to cripple Russia's international financial transactions, a Western show of unity against the country's military assault on Ukraine.
SWIFT is the world's dominant global interbank payment system, cutting banks off
will stop them from conducting most of their financial transactions worldwide and effectively block Russian exports and imports.
Four of the G7 nations say they will ban Russian gold imports in a new bid to stop oligarchs from selling the precious metal.
The European Union is considering its sixth and toughest round of sanctions yet against Russia, including a total ban on oil imports.
Today, I'm announcing the United States is targeting the main artery of Russia's economy. We're banning all imports of Russian oil and gas and energy.
More financial trouble for Russia today. The credit rating agency S&P Global says Russia effectively defaulted on its foreign debt after offering to make payments in rubles instead of dollars.
Ukrainian people have a lot of backbone. They have a lot of guts, and I'm sure you're observing it. And I don't mean just the military, which is we've been training since back when Russia moved into the southeast Ukraine, but also the average citizen. Look at how they're stepping up. And you're going to see when you're there, and sometimes you've been there, you're going to see women, young people standing in the middle of front of a damn tank, just saying, I'm not leaving. I'm holding my ground. They're incredible. But they take a lot of inspiration from us. And you know, a woman who just died, the Secretary of State, used to have an expression. She said, we are the essential nation. It sounds like a bit of a hyperbole, but the truth of the matter is, you are the organizing principle around which the rest of the world is, the free world is moving. We're in the midst of, and I don't want to sound too philosophic here, but you're in the midst of a fight between democracies and oligarchs. Xi Jinping, who I've spent more time with, they tell me, than any other world leader, points out to me he believes in China that democracies can't succeed in the 21st century. The reason is things are moving so fast, change is happening so quickly, that democracies require consensus. And we can't put together consensus as quickly as autocrats can. So what's at stake, not just in what we're doing here in Ukraine to try to help the Ukrainian people and keep the massacre from continuing, but beyond that, what's at stake is what are your kids and grandkids going to look like in terms of their freedom? What's happening? The last 10 years, fewer democracies in the form.
Donna Kostolovich and Helena Melnick are both Ukrainian. They say they're carrying drones with cameras back across the border. Their friends abroad bought them in hopes they can be used by the military.
Russia entered Ukraine unprepared for the new reality of modern warfare. The Ukrainian soldiers used a deadly combination of drones and missiles to wreak havoc on Russian forces. With inexpensive consumer drones, Ukraine could track and hunt Russian soldiers step by step. Able to see over every hill, round every corner. But drones were not the only ones in the sky. Intelligence from NATO operations enabled Ukraine to hit strategic targets, including the sinking of the Russian flagship vessel, the Moskva.
This morning, U.S. officials telling NBC News that happened with the help of the United States. Americans identified and located the vessel when asked by Ukrainian officials. This video, not verified by the Pentagon, appears to show the Moskva after it was hit, sitting low in the water with smoke billowing.
Russian forces appearing to withdraw from a few major locations in Ukraine now as the UK Ministry of Defense says that Putin's troops have suffered significant losses and that soldiers have actually failed to make any major advances in the Donbas region. Russia not backing down, though, as the Kremlin warns of a possible attack if Finland and Sweden continue their move to join NATO.
Under heavy losses, Russian troops were forced into retreat by early spring. In their wake, they massacred 1,300 civilians in the town of Buchi. Some with execution-style shootings. Russian forces were handed a total defeat in northern Ukraine, pushed back to the borders of Russia and Belarus. Russian commanders turned their focus to holding gains in the southeastern regions of Ukraine, where there are concentrations of ethnic Russians. This would allow Russia to take more fields, buried pipelines, and strategic industrial sites. But in the center of their conquest, one city stood defiant.
As we've been reporting, Mariupol of great strategic importance, one would think, to any kind of invasion by Russian forces, largely because of its huge port, its naval base, and potentially as a hub to be able to connect areas of the east, the eastern front in Donbas, with what analysts say could be a plan by Putin to connect that with the section north of Crimea to create what analysts describe as a corridor. As you can see, there's people here waiting by bus stops, very, very little traffic. The shelling here started in the early morning. It has been very sporadic. We are getting reports from...
Mariupol was approached from the east by the Russian army and for Russian militia from the Donbas region. From the west, by Russian naval infantry, special forces, and the Russian army advancing from Crimea. Mariupol was defended by Ukrainian marines, army, militia, fringe volunteers from the Georgian Legion, and the hardened Azov battalion. Within a week, the city was surrounded.
Я
301 на связи.
or fuel. We could no longer report from inside Mariupol, so we decided to join what would be the last convoy to escape.
Unable to break through the Ukrainian lines, the Russians began a merciless artillery siege, indiscriminately targeting areas densely populated with civilians.
Russian forces have continued to target the civilian areas where we're not located. And I know this firsthand because I've watched it. I've watched multiple Grad vehicles like launch their rockets into the civilian areas behind us.
Подставляем, спокуха, не нервничайте.
Of Mariupol has now been suspended. I'm joined now by Ina Dragunchuk. She is Ukraine's Vice Minister for Veteran Affairs and joins me now. We aren't saying where she is for security reasons. Ina, what is your response to the fact that these human corridors have had to be closed virtually as soon as they were opened?
These green corridors was one of the most sensitive issues to be discussed during the negotiations. And for this moment, we do expect that...
Начали торможение.
My name is Denis Prokopenko. I'm a commander of the Azov Regiment. Today is the time for determined actions. Delay can cost more and more human lives, and the world, the Europe, will heal for centuries. Create a no-fly zone over Ukraine, support with the modern weapon, organize the humanitarian aid for the civil people. We from off-site will provide the kinds of support of the international aid to protect Mariupol, its people. During the historical time, we need to stop the aggressor together, saving Mariupol, saving the Ukraine. Glory to Ukraine.
Я передаю це своїм братам-азовцям, кожному захиснику Маріуполя. Кожен день, виходячи на бойову роботу, ми думаємо про вас, ми рівняємось на вас. Ми працюємо по ворогу заради вас. Вся армія готова йти на деблокаду. Чекаємо наказу. Слава Україні!
Героям слава!
Russian forces penetrating the city. The Azov battalion and the Ukrainian marines took position in the Azovstal steel mill, a sprawling industrial complex, surrounded by water on three sides, with a maze of bunkers and tunnels below. Azovstal became a fortress housing over 3,000 soldiers, including hundreds of foreign volunteers and over 1,000 civilians. On the other side, as many as 12,000 Russian troops.
A deadline for Ukrainian troops holed up in Mariupol to lay down their arms came and went on Sunday. Russia issued the ultimatum for the outnumbered soldiers who have been defending the smouldering Azovstal steelworks. But several hours after the deadline, in the early hours of the morning, and there was no sign of surrender.
With conditions inside Azovstal deteriorating, Ukraine launched a dangerous rescue and resupply mission. Behind enemy lines, Ukrainian pilots flew just 20 feet above the ground.
Commander negotiated with the Russian commander. We're just waiting for the commander now to lay down our arms and head towards the Russian soldiers.
Professor John J. Mearsheimer.
Russia is a declining great power, and as I said to you before, if they were to try and create a greater Russia by invading Ukraine and by invading the Baltic states, they'd be jumping into the briar patch. In fact, again, if you want to wreck Russia, what you should do is tell them to try and create a greater Russia.
Хто не рискує, тут не п'ють шампанське.
The lesson for every big country is holy. We've been buying all this heavy stuff, and if people are willing to fight as heroes, fight to the last person, which it takes resolve and heroism, and they actually know how to operate because they have access to software and can use the data, they might actually be able to beat us.
Germany will become totally dependent on Russian energy if it does not immediately change course.
We're not on a sustainable path, and we haven't been for some time. And that means that the debt's growing faster than the economy, by definition, that is unsustainable. There will be a point at which it becomes a problem of servicing the debt. We're not at that point.
Are you willing to get involved militarily to defend Taiwan if it comes to that?
Yes.
You are?
It's a commitment we made.
Well, I think what we are really at an end of an era, and it's bracketed by Davos, because it was in Davos where you saw the opening up, the reconnection of what had been the Soviet Union and the Soviet satellites with the world economy, in one global economy. That's now fragmenting. Of course, no Russians here, no Chinese here, and it's back to a more fragmented, less globalized world.
Because at its basis, there is and can be no moral foundations for modern civilization.
Kenya and almost every African country was birthed by the ending of empire. Our borders were not of our own drawing. They were drawn in the distant colonial metropoles of London, Paris, and Lisbon, with no regard for the ancient nations that they cleaved apart. Today, across the border of every single African country, live our countrymen, with whom we share deep historical, cultural, and linguistic bonds. At independence, had we chosen to pursue states on the basis of ethnic, racial, or religious homogeneity, we would still be waging bloody wars these many decades later. Instead, we agreed that we would settle for the borders that we inherited, but we would still pursue continental political, economic, and legal integration. Rather than form nations that looked ever backwards into history with a dangerous nostalgia, we chose to look forward to a greatness none of our many nations and peoples had ever known.
So get yourself fixed up. I'll take you out.